For any of you for whom this is the first lecture you're attending, I'm going to introduce myself for the third time. My name is Mark Lyman. I'm a postdoctoral researcher here at the University of Chicago. I work in the Department of Astronomy and Astrophysics. And this lecture series is going to be about my area of research specialization, which is cosmology. And this particular lecture will be about the first moments of our universe's existence as we understand it today, or what some of us call the Big Bang. Now, as I've said before, and I should reemphasize, the word Big Bang gets used in two contexts and means two things. So it means simultaneously, for some people, the first moment of time's existence, or the first moment that the universe existed at all. And also, in a more technical sense, it's the time when our universe became very hot. So before we had the theory of inflation, those two times were thought to be the same time, and so there was no ambiguity in the use of the language. As the subject of the last lecture was a period of accelerated expansion of the universe that preceded the time when the universe became hot and made chemical elements and so forth. And so now we have to choose which one we mean when we say the Big Bang. I believe that it's somewhat more common to say Big Bang still means the time when the universe began. Because that's an ambiguous concept, I personally prefer to use it to refer to a more precise thing of when the universe became hot, because we know that happened at a particular time. And so it's, but I'm not criticizing anyone who prefers to use the other language. However, I just wanted to clarify what I was meaning when I said this. And just one technical, oh, the lights, right, thank you. That's one important technical note.
Yeah.
Is that good? Those of you retired can sleep now? I have to tell you, anyone who wants to sleep, there are more comfortable chairs than these. But I myself have slept in these chairs. Just one technical note, I forgot last week to put the lecture slides up, which a couple of people reminded me of this morning. While we were all assembling here, I posted them on the internet from here. So they're up now. I hope that I posted them correctly, but please do let me know if I did not. So, again, so this timeline I've been using, I will continue to use to anchor us in as we proceed through the universe's history. And we haven't moved very far from last week. Under any reasonable accounting of time, or even fairly unreasonable accountings of time, not much time has proceeded between the time when inflation happened and the time whenever the universe got very hot. So we're still way over here on the left, and we don't really have any pictorial images to describe what happened. So, those of you who were at the first lecture will recognize this slide. But this is the modern view of how the first few moments in the universe proceeded, of our particular patch of the universe. And it's important to distinguish in your mind between, so again, we still have an image in our head, in our minds of a picture of the universe that is somewhat different from what we know it to be today, which leads to language having problems describing these concepts. And so a lot of the difficulties we all have in talking about things like the Big Bang are that our language doesn't have the kind of concepts in it to characterize these things. And scientists have come up with an alternate language, which is basically jargon, for describing these things. But obviously, it takes, you have to go be a cosmologist for a while before you can pick up on this. And so for most of us, these concepts are slippery in large part because we don't have good words for them. So if you feel like it's hard to articulate in your own mind what I'm saying, and if you feel like I'm struggling to articulate in a common language what's happening, that's not an accident, and don't hold me responsible. anyway, so at the end of the last lecture, we were in a cold, post-inflationary universe. So the universe had expanded by a factor of at least 10 to the power 30, 10 with the 30 zeros behind it. And any heat or excitation of the universe had been expanded away. And so But, and so what we know is that after that, something happened, which we call reheating. That's the technical term we have for this. And it's called reheating rather than heating, because we have some idea that perhaps there's another time the universe is hot prior to inflation. But we're not really totally sure how to describe that. But anyway, we call it reheating to be safe. And what we know is that at reheating, the universe reached a very high temperature. We do not know precisely what temperature the universe reached. We know that we have direct observational evidence that it was at least 10 to the 10 Kelvin. Because 10 to the 10 Kelvin characterizes the cores of very hot stars and is the temperature at which nuclear reactions are free to operate. And so the universe stayed hot enough for nuclear reactions to operate for about 20 minutes. And during this period, the universe created a number of chemical elements. And it's the direct observation of those chemical elements that gives us direct confidence that the universe went through a period of temperature that was at least this hot. We were pretty sure that it was considerably hotter than that, but that's the one we have the most firm evidence for. So what are the facts about this? Well, one thing we can do on Earth is nuclear reactions. We can do them, we can do nuclear, and remember, so nuclear reactions have two, as we all appreciate, there's two ways that nuclear reactions can proceed. You can start with very big nuclei like uranium or plutonium, most famously, and you can break those apart. So that's fission. So you extract nuclear energy by taking something that has a large binding energy and splitting it. But in the very early universe, there weren't any big nuclei around. So that kind of nuclear reaction does not happen in the early universe. In the early universe, we start with a soup of particles, the most elementary particles. And so then what we get is fusion, where nuclear processes take the most elementary particles and start building them up into less elementary particles. And so how that proceeds, essentially, is first we imagine the state before any nuclei were formed. So the universe is extremely hot. There are protons, free neutrons, and electrons floating around. And whenever these protons and neutrons, they could run into each other and they could gain energy by forming deuterium. That's the most basic bound state of a nuclei. So it's a neutron and a proton. And so, but whenever the universe was very hot, there's lots of very high energy light around, gamma rays, for instance, that is zooming through space all everywhere. And so those gamma rays have plenty of energy in the very early universe to knock the deuterium apart. And so when the universe is extremely hot, no elements can form because as soon as they start to form, they get broken apart by the very high energy light. But all the time, the universe is expanding. And so the expanding universe essentially means the background of the universe is expanding. And so and light travels along this background. And so as the universe expands, light loses energy by stretching. And so those gamma rays that could formerly break apart deuterium become less and less common as the universe expands. And so what you get is a time whenever the universe is dense enough that the protons and neutrons can still find each other. Because remember, these are very small particles. And so you have to have a high density of these particles for them to get to be able to randomly run into each other. So the universe is just dense enough for these to get together, but not so, but it's sufficiently expanded that the light cannot sufficiently break up all of the pairs that form. And so when that starts to happen, you begin a cascade. I mean, you build up deuterium, and then the deuterium can be built into helium, which is two protons and a neutron, or into tritium, which is a proton and two neutrons. And that allows you to go up to helium-4, so the next stable element. So that one of the problems with deuterium and helium-3 is even worse, is that these are really very, very lightly bound nuclei. And so it doesn't take much to knock them apart. But helium is pretty solid. It's a very solid nucleus. And so once you get to helium-4, you're kind of safe. You have an island of stability there. And so you can imagine doing the very precise calculation where you say, well, we know how fast the universe is expanding. we know something about these nuclear reaction rates, because after all, we can do this reaction in the laboratory. And then we just have to, you know, this is what physicists do, is we do a precise calculation where we take into account these relative rates and figure out how much of everything you make. So this calculation was actually done back in the, I'm not sure, I have to look at the precise date, but it's the 30s or 40s. So it was said by these two of these three fellows. So by Ralph Alper, who was a graduate student at the time, and his PhD supervisor, George Gemow. And so what they calculated was exactly this process of hydrogen going to helium. So that was the most important one. You can go to higher elements too. The calculations get much more complicated. And you actually, to do them properly, you need really good computers. But it turns out you can get to helium with pen and paper. And so that's what Alper did. And George Gamow thought this was great. And he also really thought it was great that his student's name was Alper and his name was Gamow. And so when they were about to publish the paper, he called up his buddy Hans Bethe, who was also a nuclear physicist who had headed the Manhattan Project's theory program. And he said, "Hans, so you might have to use your name to make our paper even cooler." So I imagine we use different language, but that was essentially the upshot. And so this became known as the alpha beta gamma paper as a result. And one thing I learned in doing a little of the background research for this, and those of you in the back, you can come down, it's not going to bother you. Plenty of seats always in the front. Is that Alper was a little annoyed at Gamma for this, because Gamma was very famous, and Beta was even more famous, and he was just a graduate student. So by having two really famous people on his PhD thesis, he always thought that people gave them credit, even though he had done the hard work. So, unfortunately. But I don't know. I think that having the alpha, beta, gamma paper almost balances that out, personally. But. Anyway, so the calculation that they did has now been completed into the first few elements. And it basically takes place on this plot. And so this is a little bit complicated, so let me go through it. On the y-axis, here is the relative fraction of each of the elements. And so you see hydrogen at the top, so this is a logarithmic scale, so this each tick is a factor of 10. So hydrogen there, not changing that much, because you're using the hydrogen to make everything else, but still the universe is dominated by hydrogen. And this is time going on from wherever you start your calculation. And so what you see is that they've started the calculation where you start, as I said, first making this red line, which is the interior. This is the lowest, the simplest nucleus. And so what you do is you start building up deuterium, and lo and behold, that deuterium starts building helium-3, and those two get together and start building up helium-4. And so then you start just building up helium-4, which is this green line, and the helium-4 just keeps increasing and increasing. And at some point, and so these processes turn on first, because they're the easiest to have happen. And the helium, as you see, is the helium-4 is the one that comes to dominate because it's the most stable. And you eat up, so this black line is your free neutrons. And so free neutrons are not actually stable. They like to break up into protons and electrons. And so whenever they stop being supported, they break apart into their constituents, or they mostly just get eaten into various nuclei. And so you get mostly helium-4, and then a cascade of other elements at lower and lower abundances. And so this is this very precise calculation in two stages is a thing that takes about 20 minutes to happen. And so it's really, in some ways, this the hydrogen, helium, deuterium calculation was the first calculation of what we now call precision cosmology, because at the end you get you just get a number. You say that it takes two inputs. One is how fast is the universe expanding, and two, how much matter is there? What's the background density of matter? Because that is a free parameter. You don't know how much matter there is in your universe. And you put those two numbers in, and you get a precise number. So you take two numbers, and you get something like 13% or 28%. And so then having done the calculation, you can imagine doing the experiment where you go out to the universe and try to see how much hydrogen and helium there is. Now, between the beginning of the universe and today, a lot has happened in 14 billion years. And so the hydrogen-helium ratio in, say, the sun, we have good reasons to think that that's not exactly the same it was as immediately after the Big Bang. And so to do this calculation really precisely, what you'd like to know is what you do is try to find patches or places that we can observe that haven't had much happen since the Big Bang, sort of dull neighborhoods without any parties. And then look there to see what the relative abundance of hydrogen versus helium and lithium and deuterium is, and use that to compare with your Big Bang nucleosynthesis calculations. And so that's what people have done. And as you can see, there's basically one free parameter here because we now know the expansion rate very well of the early universe because we know it was dominated by radiation. So that we can just, and actually alpha and gamma into that. So the last piece of the puzzle is you just have to put in a number for the density of ordinary matter. And they back when they did their calculation, they only had a rough idea of what this would be. But we now have a very precise percent level determination of what the amount of matter is. So we just plug it in, and that's this blue bar. This is our modern determination of how much matter there is. And these green, red, blue, and purple lines are the predictions of this theory for how much of these various elements there will be for various densities of ordinary matter. And the black boxes are the observations. So you see that you really nailed it. So there's just the right amount of hydrogen, of helium. There's just the right amount of deuterium. And lithium, it looks a little weird, but it does seem to overlap. And so but these are really the ones that are the clearest calculations. So helium and deuterium, we nailed it, so we understand what was going on for the most part. And we know that the Big Bang happened in something very closely resembling this way. Now, just because this part of this lecture series isn't just to be a hoorah, let's hooray for cosmologists, but to also tell you about what's actually going on in the field, I wanted to show you this paper from 2008, so very recently, where people are worried about this phenomenon that the lithium doesn't seem to be quite so closely matched. And so this plot is actually a few years old. And so what people have been trying to do is to tighten up the lithium calculation. Now, lithium, as I said, is much harder, not only because it requires many more reactions and therefore careful computer simulations to do, but also because we have to know all of the nuclear reaction rates to very high precision to put into these computer simulations. And so that's an experiment we can do on Earth. We have lithium, we have hydrogen, we have helium. We can make deuterium, it's fine. We just throw them at each other in nuclear physics labs and get to make very precise measurements of exactly how often they interact. And so everyone assumed that if you just did these experiments more carefully, then the lithium prediction would get sharper and it would agree with the experiments better. But the surprising thing is that so these people did that calculation. They worked with nuclear physicists and made the measurements, and it got worse. And I mean, of course, the title is a little riff on the fact that lithium has other uses besides being something produced in the early universe. And so, just to show you, so you can see here. So the yellow curves represent the theoretical the blue curves represent the theoretical predictions. And the yellow curves represent the actual observations in astronomy. And so you see, we have really good agreement for this one. It's called YP, but that's just physics lingo for hydrogen, for helium fraction. This is the deuterium one. They both basically nailed it. It's really hard to see helium-3, so we have a prediction with no observations. And then lithium, they just don't match. It's just off. And we're not sure why. People have some ideas about what's going on there, but in fact, one of the cleverest ones I've seen will actually be tested by the Large Hadron Collider. Several of them involve introducing new nuclear physics, and so this is just to show you that even this great triumph, a 50-plus-year-old calculation, still has new surprises waiting in it. So, the universe is not a boring place. So, okay, so that's the best understood metaphysics from the Big Bang, from the hot early universe. But we know other stuff, there are other facts that we know happened during the early universe. And one of those is that, you know, obviously we have regular matter that was made in the early universe, where of course we were here. There's also all this dark matter. Now, I mentioned in the first lecture that there's this dark matter, that the majority of matter in the universe is composed of this dark matter. And what this dark matter is, just to remind you, is that through gravitational observations of galaxies, we see that there's a lot of stuff in galaxies that isn't making any light. And so, since it doesn't make light, we call it dark matter. This is pretty much all we know about it. There's a lot of it, much more of it than there is ordinary matter. And it's not making any light. And if it's not making any light, then that leads us to conclude that it's not interacting with the electromagnetic force. And the fact that we never see it in our experiments leads us to conclude that it also doesn't interact with the strong nuclear force, because otherwise it'd be relatively easy to see. And so what does that mean? So we've seen it gravitationally. It doesn't interact with electromagnetism. Doesn't interact with the strong nuclear force. We only got four forces. And so what we people guess is that maybe it's something that interacts with the weak nuclear force. We can test this intuition. So again, much like in the case of the nucleosynthesis, whenever you're making dark matter, we don't know the theory that describes this. This is pure theory, speculation. But whatever makes it is we think that this dark matter is a fundamental particle. So it's something like an electron or like a top quark. It's something that is not, it's not like a nucleus. It's something that is fundamental by itself. This is our theory. We could be wrong. And sometimes people try to come up with theories where the dark matter is in fact nuclei of some other stuff that we can't see. Maybe that's true. But the simplest theory is to say that the dark matter is all some other fundamental particle. And that fundamental particle has some other rules. And we can calculate, and basically we can use the fact that we know how much dark matter there is now to try to back calculate what kind of physics described this dark matter. Because we can basically do the same theoretical exercise for dark matter that we did for the nuclear reaction. And just say, whatever is making this dark matter, it can make it in the very hot early universe, but as the universe cools down, it stops being able to make it because the interactions get too low, too cool, too low energy. And so at some point, it freezes out at some particular abundance. There's some certain amount that's left over. That's what I'm trying to picture here, is that when the universe is really small and dense, the dark matter particles, no matter how shy they are about interacting, eventually they get crammed up so close to each other that they hit each other and interact. But as the universe expands, then they stop seeing each other. They stop hitting each other, and then they get frozen out, and then just end up with however many are left at some point. And so that's the calculation we can do and have done. And so basically what you get is, again, a predicted amount of dark matter on the y-axis, and here versus time. And so you can see that the amount of dark matter starts at some amount, and you do this calculation, and it goes down as it gets broken apart by these interactions. But then at some special time, the universe gets cool enough that it stops interacting. So it just freezes out. You get stuck with whatever abundance you have, and then it just goes flat. And so, the really amazing thing, the thing we call the WIMP miracle, is that if you put in the strength of the weak nuclear force, the nuclear force that makes nuclei spontaneously decay, we've observed that, we know how strong that force is. If you put in that force strength into your calculation, you get exactly the right answer that we see in cosmological observations. So this is regarded as strong evidence that if the dark matter is a fundamental particle, then it interacts with a weak nuclear force.
How do you know the amount you're going to when you start it?
We don't, but it turns out not to be that sensitive to that. So you can start it at various points here, and it'll always just sort of come down and end up with the same volume. So it's not sensitive to the initial conditions. That's an excellent question, and something you should always ask. And so, And so this is how, actually, people are doing experiments now to try to look for the dark matter by using, so basically, this, if you know it does, in fact, interact with a weak nuclear force, you can put experiments on the Earth to wait for it to have weak nuclear force interactions with stuff on Earth. And this basically amounts to big vats of water, which it will hit every once in a while, we hope. We haven't seen it yet. Well, some people think they may have seen it, but it's not certain. But we'll come back to that in a future lecture. So I wanted to go, the last thing we know that happened in the early universe for sure, and that which I already alluded to, is that we ended up with matter, so ordinary matter, baryons, as cosmologists we know baryons. Oh, I forgot to say that, so I call it the WIMP miracle, but I didn't say what WIMP was. You all know what WIMP means to in normal terms, but it actually stands for something. It's the weakly interacting massive particle. And this is actually, at least half the reason for that name was because the competing theory for dark matter in the early days was called macho. Machos, which were massive, compact halo objects. And so the WIMPs won. Okay, so this is something that I've been asked about a number of times in the questions. And so I wanted to spend a few minutes talking about matter and antimatter. Because we're obviously, so we call ourselves matter, but we also have all now heard of this exotic stuff called antimatter. And so what is antimatter? So antimatter, it's one of these things that seems exotic, but we've known about it now for a long time. It really is, in some sense, it's not, if we all had antimatter machines at home like TVs, we wouldn't think antimatter was so crazy. Because we can make antimatter just about as well as we can make cathode ray tubes. It's not very hard to make. It's the only reason we aren't familiar with it is because it doesn't hang around for very long. So every matter particle has an antiparticle partner. And that antiparticle partner is its antimatter counterpart. And so the simplest one is an electron's partner is a positron. So the name of the positron clues you into the second fact about antimatter, which is that antiparticles have the opposite electrical charge as their particle pairs. So electron is negatively charged, so positron is positively charged. And whenever they get together, they annihilate each other and form light. So you have one plus one bit of matter, minus one bit of antimatter, you put them together, the sum stays the same, zero. But you trade two particles for zero particles, and you end up with light instead. So that's how antimatter interacts. And you might wonder if antimatter is gravitational or anti-gravitational. It's gravitational. It gravitates just like ordinary matter. There was no reason to think it shouldn't, but the people did the experiment anyway. And so you can take positrons and spin them around and watch them fall. And so we know that it gravitates like ordinary matter. And so, again, so how we see this antimatter typically is by its interactions with matter. And so if you take an electron and a positron and put them together, then they make gamma rays, it turns out, so the light, so photon. And so we can actually see this happening in many places, including at the center of our galaxy. Positrons are spontaneously made through some processes in the center of the galaxy. And so you see characteristic gamma rays coming from this interaction. And so because of the way that physics works, if you can take two gamma rays and make positrons and electrons, in the same, if you can take electrons and positrons and make gamma rays, and you can turn it around to take two gamma rays and make electrons and positrons. And this is called pair production of positrons and electrons. And this is more or less how they're generated. Is you just get radiation together and have it make matter and antimatter. So just a historical note is that antimatter is well beloved of physicists, not only because it just sounds cool, but also because it was one of the great and very relatively few instances where theoretical physics was years ahead of experiments. And so this man, Paul Dirac, is the discoverer of antimatter. And so the story goes that he was studying the Schrodinger equation. Now the Schrodinger equation, you probably have heard of, is the differential equation that describes how quantum mechanics works. And this was discovered by Schrodinger. in the early part of the 20th century. And so the Schrodinger equation has a very obvious problem, that it doesn't work if the particle, if the quantum mechanics reactions are happening close to the speed of light. It's not relativistic. And so it was not compatible with Einstein's theory of special relativity. And Schrodinger knew this, everybody knew this. It was just really hard to figure out how to get those two together, those two theories together. And it was Dirac who figured out how to do that. And the equation he came up with is known as the Dirac equation in his honor. And so the fascinating thing that Dirac's equation said, and part of the reason why it was so hard to figure out how to get to the Dirac equation from the Schrodinger equation, is that you couldn't have electrons by themselves in the Dirac equation. For the Dirac equation to work, you had to have the positions for not just two states, because we knew that the electron has two states. We can have spin up and spin down electrons. So this is, electrons have intrinsic angular momentum. This is a technical point. But basically, in the equation, you have to have two spots for electrons, a spin up and a spin down spot. But the Dirac equation doesn't work with only two spots. It says there have to be four. And this is basically what Dirac said. It's like, well, I found the relativistic generalization of Schrodinger's equation, and there's these extra spots in it. And that's kind of where he stopped, because he was a very awkward man. And he didn't, and people now think he was borderline autistic, maybe he had Asperger's syndrome. Because most of us, on discovering basically the prediction of a brand new particle, you know, you run to your terminal colleagues who love this stuff and say, hey, you know, you want to find a particle named after me? but not Dirac. So Dirac found it, he published it, and he would give talks on it, and people would say things like, you know, Dirac, they're doing these experiments, they might find your particle. And just said, mm-hmm. And so then they did the experiments, and they found these particles, these positrons, that he predicted, but didn't ever, like, he didn't go out and trumpet himself. And people would, at talks, would say, Dirac, they found your particles. And he'd be like, And so, but I mean, he was obviously he's been recognized for since, but he himself didn't seem to be eager to trumpet this, which is an interesting point. So, but to return to cosmology, this matter antimatter imbalance. So, just to deal with one question that someone asked in the first lecture, we know that there's matter around us. And there's not the antimatter around us. So the usual conclusion is that something in the early universe made slightly more matter than antimatter. But someone in the first lecture asked the question, this is an excellent question, but maybe there's just as much antimatter as matter. It's just, you know, this galaxy is matter, and then some other very distant galaxy is an entirely antimatter galaxy. There's actually no problem with that, for fundamental physics. But there actually is an observational problem, and that's because if you have patches of the universe where they're all antimatter, there's going to have to be some place where they go through a transition, where, you know, this is the antimatter side, then you switch to the matter side. And in those patches, because matter and antimatter annihilate, they would make gamma rays, they would get these cascades of gamma rays, just always happening. And, you know, 50 years ago, this would have been a good solution because we didn't have any way of looking for gamma rays in space. Or gamma rays, period. We didn't have any way of observing for them. But we now do. We actually have excellent gamma ray observatories. And we don't see any of these cascades. So there must not be these antimatter regions of space. So we're stuck with the universe just making more matter than antimatter in the first moments. But just to emphasize, so the universe... The imbalance between matter and antimatter does not have to be very big to account for how much matter there is now. And so this is a nice picture that I found, that basically you have, for every 10 billion antimatter pieces, you can have, all you need is 10 billion and one matter particles. And all the 10 billion can cancel each other out, you end up with one plus one matter. And that's enough to make all of the matter we have. Because that's just, in the early universe, there's just so much, the density is so high, there's so many particles around, that all you need is a very, very small amount. And so, But this is, again, it's another one of these quantitative questions, right, where just like the nuclear reactions, just like the dark matter freeze out, it seems like you should be able to just take the fundamental physics in an expanding universe and say, well, this is how much matter there should be. But this has actually proved to be very challenging, and this is not a solved problem. But we know that there are three conditions that are necessary for it to work. These were written down by a famous Soviet physicist named Sakharov, who was also famous for his dissident views about the Communist Party of Russia, which got him in a lot of trouble. He was a great cosmologist as well. And so Sakharov's three conditions are the first one is very simple. Basically, that the laws of physics have to let you make more matter than antimatter. Seems like that seems very clear. So you have to have some fundamental law that allows matter to be made, but not antimatter. Because if you have to make one-for-one pairs, then you're never going to get ahead and get more matter than antimatter. And so just illustrating that here, if you have green and red matter and antimatter, if you start with the same amount, then at some later time, you have to end up with more matter than antimatter. And so the status of this is there's a ton of ideas for how to do this, actually. Because physicists, if we can do one thing, is that we can make up stuff. And so people just say, well, how about this? And you know, we talk about it. And actually, if this particular problem has a problem, is that there's too many solutions and we can't tell the difference. This frustrates a lot of people because they would like for their theory to be right, but we haven't figured out a way of confirming which of these is true. But that's not all you need. So you might think this is all you need, but it turns out no. Basically because, and the reason why is because as I was saying to you, so like as when you take a positron and an electron and make gamma rays, and then you take two gamma rays and make a positron and an electron, if you have a process that can take, they can go from zero matter to plus one matter, then always in physics you have a reverse process that says plus one matter back to zero matter. And as long as those are happening equally fast, then you never end up with an excess anyway. And so you need, so in addition to that, that was a fundamental physics rule, you need something else. And this is the most technical one, so don't strain yourself too much if this doesn't make sense. But I have to try to explain it at least. And so that, for this one, you need your physical laws to have to violate a symmetry called charge parity symmetry. And so let me just tell you what charge and parity symmetry are separately. So charge symmetry is the easiest. If you have a charge symmetry, that means that the laws of physics look just the same if you change from positive charge to negative charge. We know that this is not true because you can, as we all know, if you take an electron and go through a magnetic field, this is something I think they saw once in high school physics, and many of you probably taught it in high school physics. So if you have an electron going through a magnetic field, an electron turns one way and a positron turns the opposite way. So obviously charge symmetry is not respected. But if you switch to parity symmetry, if you add parity symmetry, parity symmetry basically says, look at the experiment in the mirror. So everything that was on the left hand switched to the right hand, and everything that was spinning this way spins the other way. So that's why I put these spirals going the opposite direction on either side of this page. And then you see that the electron-positron combination does respect charge parity symmetry, because if you have an electron going this way and it turns up, and then if you take a positron and flip it around, and you flip that twice, and you get a positron path going the other way. And so that's the charge parity symmetry. And many people for many years thought that if you charge and parity separately were violated, but charge parity, if you switch both at the same time, then all the physics laws will look just the same. And so what Sakharov said was no. He said, if you want to make matter and not antimatter, you've got to break the symmetry in your fundamental laws. And so this is something that people were really skeptical of, and then they just observed it. They did an experiment, and you manifestly saw that basically, if you had that one experiment going on, if you had seen a mirror image of it, and you told the people, the observers, that they didn't tell them they were looking in a mirror, and you told them that the stuff they were looking at had the opposite charge and was really there, then you can tell the difference. by watching the experiment take place, of which, whether you're looking through a mirror or not. It's amazing. And it was actually done by a physicist here at Chicago. He's now at Chicago. I'm not sure if he was here when he found this. Named James Cronin, who I have a funny story about personally, is that I was the first time I visited Chicago, as I was working somewhere else. And I was in the visitor's office, and he had been kicked out of his office because they were cleaning or something. And so he was also sitting in the visitor's office. And this is older physicist clearly sitting there, and oh, hi, who are you? And we talked for a bit, and he introduced himself. And I asked him what he worked on, and he told me. And then, as you often do in these times, I then looked him up, and I thought, oh. I should have known who you are. He was very graceful about it, gracious about it. It made much more sense of the smile that he had on his face when I asked him who he was, and then didn't recognize. That's not it. So you need those two things. The last thing you need, which is actually just to finish that previous point. And so this one, which seemed like it might be the hardest to get, is actually we know it's true. So this one's easy. We know what happens. The third one is actually proved to be the hardest to figure out, and that is, in addition to those two previous rules, which are rules where you just write down those fundamental physics laws that get both of those right, you need something else that is outside of your basic equations, and that is, it has to do with the environment in which these reactions take place in the early universe. And then you need these reactions to take place out of equilibrium. So in equilibrium, we know what equilibrium is. We're all familiar with that. Equilibrium is when nothing is changing. So if in an oven that's been heated up, it has nothing in it. The interior of the oven is in equilibrium. The walls are not trading heat with the. There's as much heat coming out of the walls as the going into the air as vice versa, approximately. But then you put your cold turkey in there, or pie, or whatever you like to bake, and then suddenly becomes an out of equilibrium system because you have a cold item in a hot bath. And so then you have exchange of heat. So that's an out of equilibrium process, and it's trying to go back to equilibrium. And so physics processes always like to move towards equilibrium. And so in the early universe, things are generally speaking, we think, in equilibrium. But Sakharov showed that you need something out of equilibrium to happen to have matter get created. And so what this has to be, so we're not sure what this was. I would say that the most popular idea is that what you had happen was something akin to bubble formation. So formation of bubbles is essentially, I'm trying to think of a good example for this. Something that happens in phase transition. So a good way of thinking about this is when you make ice. So if you made perfect ice, then that ice would never have a crack in it, right? Because it would be just an individual sea crystal that would form, and the entire ice crystal would grow from that in a perfect lattice, and it would be a perfect crystal. But as we all know, if you look at an ice cube, the average ice cube is not perfect, a perfect ice crystal, because water crystals are transparent, but most of our ice cubes are not transparent, particularly not the ones that make in my freezer. And the reason for that is because there are many sea crystals, and those crystals, when they grow together, they make their walls where they mismatch. And so, it's okay, it still forms together into ice, but it's not a perfect crystal. And so, anytime you have a phase transition, when you go from one phase like water to another phase like a solid like ice, it's possible to have these mismatches in space where the new phases don't quite match up. And so the idea is that in fundamental physics, you can have an analogous process go on, where as the universe goes through some crazy, weird phase transition, similar things happen. You're not making a crystal, but you're making a new phase of something else, some other phase. And you would also have these walls in space where the two phases wouldn't match. And these walls in space would look like spheres or bubbles. And then those bubbles could run into each other as they expanded. And then the place where these bubbles hit each other to be where the out of equilibrium physics would happen. And so it's kind of a crazy idea. It's possible that it can happen, but we aren't sure exactly how. That's probably the best, most popular idea we've got. So that was all the facts about the early universe, about the earlier moments of the universe we know. And obviously, there's also some speculation in there. But, you know, we all like to dream big, and we all want to be, essentially, every theoretical physicist would love to be direct, only not quite so modest, and guess something's existence before the experimenter sees it. So this is something we're always doing, is we're trying to figure out things that are consistent with our current understanding, but push it to the next step, where we say, well, you know, these equations seem to allow you to have this thing, so let's go look for it. And this is a good process for figuring out what's going on in the universe. And so one such speculation that I spent some of my research time working on is some objects called cosmic strings or cosmic superstrings. And I've taken this picture from a scientific documentary with an artist's conception of a cosmic string. And by this, I think you all recognize this is actually Star Trek. So the Starship Enterprise in Star Trek encountered a cosmic string and apparently. Apparently the copyright infringement. Sorry, I'll take it down. This is actually not what a cosmic string would probably look like, but did you kind of know that your theory, the theoretical thing you've worked on has made it whenever it's been on Star Trek? And so cosmic strings are actually, these cosmic strings are actually a generalization of this, are actually a consequence of these kind of bubble. So I'm talking about these bubbles in the previous slide. And so it turns out that for some theories that where you make these bubbles, that the laws of physics don't allow the bubble walls to go away entirely. And in these theories, what you end up with is, so the edges of those edges of the bubble, instead of just being, so if you think about these bubbles, so you go through a phase transition, and just like in your water, as the crystal's going out, there's still a liquid in between, right? And so also in these cosmological phase transitions, as these bubbles expand, the stuff between the bubbles is in the old phase, is in the way the universe used to be before the phase transition. And so in some of these theories, that old phase, that the water-like stuff, gets stuck, and there are lines in space where the physics just, because of the symmetries of the physics, you get stuck with a little bit of water, like little tubes of water. It's as if you have little tubes of water cutting through your ice. And the physics doesn't allow those tubes to go away. And so what you have are little remnants of the old phase, the way the universe used to be, living in the new phase. And so obviously, the space isn't ice, and the cosmic strings aren't water, but that's the analogy of what's happening. And so the idea is that if you have something like these bubbles, which we need something like bubbles to happen to make matter. And so it's not crazy to think that you might also end up with these superstring lines of the leftovers of the early universe and the current universe. And the way that so I actually have a movie of how that would happen, of a simulation. And so what you see is that flash was the making of all those bubbles. And so just to go through it one more time, so it starts with the universe all white, that's the old phase. It goes to the new phase where it becomes transparent, but the white places are where the old phase is preserved, and those are the strings. And so if you look carefully, you saw that there were spheres that were formed, and those are those bubbles, and they hit each other, and you end up with these lines. And so we can make simulations of this happening, and then once we have those simulations, we can watch those lines evolve, and they interact with each other using these rules that we've come up with. And so the idea, these strings are really crazy objects because they're really, really, really heavy. So 1 centimeter of cosmic string would weigh about 10 to the 20 grams. So that's so a constant string that sort of, if you made a constant string that went around the sun or like across the solar system, that would weigh about as much as the sun itself in mass. And so they're extremely dense objects, but because they're this trap state of when the universe is extremely dense. And so constant strings can do a lot of really cool things. We haven't observed any of them, unfortunately. But one of the things that we know, if they did exist, and this, so you can put them into the equations of general relativity, and if they do exist, one of the things they would do is bend light. But they bend light unlike any other object bends light. So usually, light bending, so gravity, general relativity tells us that that light itself is bent by gravitational force. But usually it happens very much like light in a in a lens, so that sort of it gradually bends as it passes through. But light going by a cosmic string doesn't bend like that at all. So a cosmic string actually doesn't bend space around it. What it does is it sort of takes a sliver out of space and makes a space into a cone, a very flat cone, but a cone around it. So there's actually, if you knew there was a cosmic string right here, and you added up all the angles around the cosmic string, it would be less than 360. So the actual space around the cosmic string has been deformed into a conical shape. And what that allows you to do is, if you just imagine if you had two parallel light beams going by a cosmic string, then they would no longer, after they pass the cosmic string, they would actually be deflected relative to each other and come to the same spot. And so what that means in practice for observers is that if you have a very distant galaxy, so if something's far enough away, then you can think about the light from it being a bunch of different parallel lines of images of that object. And so usually, in regular space, you only see one of those images. And so you see one copy of a galaxy or one copy of a star. But if there's a cosmic string between us and that galaxy or star, then we could, in principle, see two, because we would get both the one that was coming to us anyway, and also one that should have gone, that should not have come to us, but that gets bent and does come to us. I'll get your question in a second. We're almost done. And you can imagine other things happening. So this is an image, a sort of whimsical image from one of my own papers, where if you imagine there are three cosmic strings meeting at a point, you can imagine seeing a galaxy three times, all undistorted, perfectly undistorted copies, because we're going by this cosmic string. And so it's something that we haven't seen. It would be very interesting if we did see it, but it's not observed. And so I think I'm out of time for now, and that's basically all I had to say. So thank you very much. I'll be happy to take questions now. Anyone who needs to leave or wants to leave is free to do so. There's handouts in the back. I'm not sure if there's some left on both sides, but if there's not any on your side and you want one, there's some on the other side. Okay, so one question in the back. Yeah. Lenses in front of us. And if these lenses worked like cosmic strings, there'd be no point in wearing them, because light going through a cosmic string is neither magnified nor demagnified. It doesn't change the character. It doesn't cause convergence or divergence. It just turns. And so gravitational lenses like those of galaxies or clusters or black holes, they all cause convergence of light just the way that optical lenses do. And so what you see, we actually take advantage of this. And so we see galaxies that are very far away behind gravitational lenses, because the gravitational lenses actually magnify those galaxies for us. And just like optical lenses can magnify things. Cosmic string lensing, on the other hand, is a very strange kind of lensing, because all it is a turn. It's like more like a mirror in that way. It's not a mirror. It's not hitting anything. But like light in a mirror is changed in its direction but undistorted. So also is the light that goes by a cosmic string just changed in its direction but undistorted. Does that answer your question?
I'm not sure.
Okay. Actually, a number of theories for, and we're not totally sure, to be honest. So one thing to remember, so an important fact to remember is that energy. So in cosmology, whenever you have gravity in a system, as we do in cosmology, energy is not conserved. So the conservation of energy is not a fundamental principle of gravitational systems, because you can gain as much energy as you like by taking it out of the curvature of space. And so you don't need to conserve energy more, at least not absolutely. And so what this allows you to do, at least in your imagination, is to say, well, whatever was causing inflation to happen basically can bind up some energy. It can have some remaining energy that's trapped in some potential form of some sort. And that potential energy gets converted into kinetic energy. And so that's more or less the intuitive idea of what's happening. After inflation, you have energy trapped in some way, and that energy gets something drastic happens, a phase transition of some sort, where a tremendous amount of energy is suddenly released. But we're not exactly sure how that goes. In fact, I mean, one of my current research projects is precisely trying to address this question. So I'd like to know myself. Okay. What?
Yeah. Seeing these cosmic strings would depend upon with any reasonable likelihood, for observing their effects on light, would depend on the size of the bubbles being smaller than the inflationary portion that condensed out.
Right.
And it's very, 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 very substantially smaller. But I thought the homogeneity produced by inflation, in essence, was depending on that not being the case.
Right.
So would that imply that you couldn't see strength?
That is actually a very good question. So, and indeed, you actually touched on something that's one of these really interesting points, because you have to ask the question of what happens before and after inflation. So if you want to see, so if you made these before inflation happened, yeah, you're right. There aren't any to see. And so you only could see them if this, whatever is allowed to make them, happens during the reheating portion of the universe's history. So post-inflationary rather than pre or during inflation.
And do you have any rule with the idea that the laws of physics change post-inflation?
Oh, yes, well, they had to have changed. We know they've changed at least a couple of times. Because if we made dark matter, that's clearly not described by the laws we already have.
But if those were made dark matter was created at least during inflation.
No, it was, that was also post-inflation, because dark matter also, if it happened, if the dark matter were made during inflation, it also would be diluted, and there wouldn't be any left. So, I mean, all of the things that I talked about today had to be made after inflation for us to see. No, you're absolutely correct that you can certainly imagine these processes happening in the universe, in the inflationary universe. It would all be inflated away. And one of the things I didn't say actually in the last lecture is that the problem that Alan Guth was trying to solve whenever he symbolized inflation actually had nothing to do with the cosmological problems. But the theories of the day exactly made something like cosmoscopes called monopoles, which are points in space that are of the old days rather than lines in space. And whenever they tried to write these theories down, you had this problem that you made way too many monopoles. And so his very first thought was, hey, I can get rid of the monopoles by making inflation. And so exactly what you said. And then he only later realized that solving the monopole problem was the least cool thing that inflation did. But you're absolutely right. So it's very important to ask when we're making these theories whether the characteristic energy scale that these things are created at is inflationary or post-inflationary. Yes?
Did inflation cause cooling of matter?
So there were probably, if you had some matter around, so if you dropped a pot of beans into the universe while it was inflating, then that would definitely cool down because the space is expanding so fast that it cooled everything down. And just cooled it down through adiabatic contraction. So the same way that that anything expanding cools, But the important thing to remember is that we basically have, because of inflation, we've forgotten about anything that preceded inflation, or we can't access it. And so all of the matter and things that we're familiar with had to have been made after inflation concluded. And so the universe was no longer inflated when these things were made.
Yeah. So the strings are basically one dimension.
That's correct. Okay. Yeah. They're much longer than they are wide. So their width would be narrower than the width of a nucleus. They're three dimensional. Their width is just so tiny that you can essentially think of them as one dimensional. But it's just really, really narrow. The narrowest string you can imagine. Yes.
Would it be possible to actually have equal amounts of matter and antimatter if our observable universe was a small fraction of the total universe, and these antimatter galaxies and the gamma ray zones could be beyond our cosmic horizon? Wouldn't that be a possibility?
It would be a possibility. It would be tricky because we can essentially see, we can almost see back to the period, the epoch, whatever matter and antimatter were made. And so it would have to be essentially we'd have to very, very violently violate the principles of this sort of homogeneity, because you'd have to have reactions that went strongly in one direction and strongly in a different direction. So you can imagine, certainly, there's nothing excluding that observationally, but it would be, it's from an operational standpoint of trying to come up with a theory to describe that, you struggle to think of how you can make that happen. But it would certainly be a viable solution if you could figure out a good way to do it.
Matter and antimatter annihilation happen? Wasn't it very early? So there was something, and wouldn't that make a huge difference?
It happened very early. It happened before nucleosynthesis. It did indeed make a huge amount of energy. But remember, so that you probably started with, and we aren't sure, but you probably start with a lot of something that's neither matter nor antimatter, something like light, and then you just make both. And you create both matter and antimatter out of that, and then they annihilate and go back into the radiation. And so it takes a lot of energy to create the matter and antimatter first. And so it depends on where you start your clock. So if you think of it as sort of like starting with a bucket of matter and a bucket, an anti-bucket of antimatter, and you pour them together, then yeah, you generate a whole lot of energy. But that's once you started your clock having already generated these two buckets. But if you start with, but you haven't changed the total matter energy budget, as it were, if you have to make it first. So it doesn't, whatever it was that generated all this energy, it was probably not the matter and antimatter colliding, because you probably had to go about making it first before they can interact. Does that answer your question?
It was made by inflation. Could it have been the Big Bang later?
So after inflation, you make something. It's distinctly possible that whatever it was that caused reheating essentially just created a whole lot of matter and antimatter particles. That is absolutely possible. And then they annihilated, and that heated everything up. That is more or less one of the popular ways of having inflation in this, to do something very much like that.
Isn't some baryonic matter made up of both quarks and anti-quarks?
Yes. So they're only short-lived bound states. But just to clarify for everyone else, so the question was whether some baryonic matter is made of quarks and anti-quarks or anti-partners. And just to remind people, baryonic matter is the physics name for ordinary matter, and baryons are basically everything that are made out of quarks. So there's baryons and there's leptons. Electrons are leptons. And so they have nuclei, which are baryonic, and then electrons, which are leptonic. And you combine them together and you get atomic matter. He's making the correct recognition that in our particle accelerators, we regularly make particles that are themselves a bound state of a particle and an antiparticle. An up and an anti-up quark, for instance, can make a bound state, or any pair of up of quarks. And then the reason they can make a bound state is because they're oppositely charged. And so so just like hydrogen is a bound state of an electron and a proton, bound together by the electrical charge, so also a fundamental particle and its antiparticle can make a bound state. But these bound states just don't last very long for the reason that as soon as those antiparticles interact with each other, they annihilate into radiation. And but we can see that precise process happening, where you start with a bound state, and then, much like it's quite funny because so one of the ways we understand the structure of hydrogen is by you can see the radiation, the transitions of the electron going from higher to lower energy levels. This is the Lyman series, or the other series of actual radiation transitions as the electron jumps around on the energy levels of hydrogen. And so it actually almost precisely the same mathematics describes. You have a quark and anti-quark question. As they jump between the energy levels of their separation, you see a series of radiation emissions as they jump together. And then they finally hit each other and you get a burst of gamma rays. And so this is actually exactly what you see. And that's how you know you made these pairs. Yes, sir?
Yes. I remember reading that in the grand unified theory, we had X particles. And the possibility that the Big Bang created X particles. The X particles could have a differing decay scheme, different decay rate. And that's what led to the preponderance of matter over antimatter.
That is one of the theories, correct. So what the gentleman is referring to is that, so one of the concepts that is, one of the observationally suggested, though not fully confirmed, concepts is that we know that at least three of the fundamental forces, electromagnetism, the weak nuclear force, and the strong nuclear force, they all change their interaction strength depending on the energy of the experiment you're doing. And so we have seen in the colliders that the electromagnetic and weak forces can be unified at an energy scale, at a particular energy scale. And so if you draw a plot of if you draw a plot as you go to higher energies of the strong and the weak forces, as they go to higher energy, they seem to be converging. And so if we extrapolate that backwards, at some point, they match. And so and this is what's called grand unification, where all three forces are all, in fact, fundamentally the same force, all with the same strength. To do this, to make this actually happen, you have to introduce new physics principles. And one of the ideas is that there's some very, very heavy particle, often called the X particle, that is a a sort of a player at the grand unified temperature, but is so heavy that it basically doesn't last very long and decays after you leave those temperatures. And so this X particle could be the thing that generates more matter than antimatter, because it's relatively straightforward in these theories to make a decay that makes more matter than antimatter. There are constraints on the X particles, though, because it's sort of a funny and surprising fact that water is basically made of hydrogen and oxygen, right? And hydrogen, if you have X particles and protons themselves, of every one, very, very rarely, but every once in a while, will spontaneously decay by formation of an X particle. And then the X particle obviously can become anything. And so we actually have experiments where you just have big vats of water and you wait around for proton decay. And that's a way of measuring how heavy an X particle is. And we've never seen it happen yet. And so this keeps pushing as we wait. I mean, it's like every day you just kind of, there's various experiments, like waiting for dark matter to hit your experiment, waiting for protons to decay. You can actually run them both at the same time because nothing ever happens. I always feel bad for these guys because they are such good experimenters and they check everything so carefully that they never see anything. And it's important that for them to keep doing their experiments. It's gotta be hard, you know, your 20th year, you don't have your experiments. You see anything, Jim? No, I don't know. So they still haven't seen it. So as you push the mass of the X higher and higher through these experiments, it becomes harder and harder for them to explain the observations. And so I don't think it's ruled out yet, but that's a constraint on it. Yes, sir.
What compels us to assume that inflation happens so fast? What would happen if we assume 20 billion years or longer? Inflation
happens
in a fraction of a second.
No, it has to happen so fast because essentially because of remember I was talking about last week, I talked about these perturbations. And so for them to be quantum perturbations, you essentially have to have things happen at an atomic mechanical length scale, and then have that blown up to a macroscopic length scale. And so that sets a time scale. That introduces an actual sort of clock for how fast things have to go. And that tells you that it has to happen on these very rapid timescales, because otherwise you can't get the quantum perturbations. If you wanted to have some sort of leisurely inflation at big length scales, you wouldn't make quantum perturbations of the right size.
So because of the scale.
So it's an actual observable. You can test it. We did the experiment. It's not that. Somebody has not asked a question yet? Yes.
Yeah, during the high density phase, when presumably antimatter was largely annihilated, and produced presumably gamma rays, shouldn't there be evidence of that, a kind of gamma ray background?
It's been expanded out since then. So that radiation background is precisely the subject of the next lecture. And so essentially you make a whole lot of really high energy radiation of the early universe. And as the universe cools off, it gets stretched. And the characteristic wavelength of the early universe radiation that comes to us today is now microwaves. And so it's actually, that is precisely what I'll be talking about next week, is the remnant radiation from the big bang.
Well, I thought cosmic ray background radiation is something else, but
no, so
part of that is the annihilation of antimatter.
Sure, it all goes in. It's not separate. It's just all one big blob of everything. You make a bunch of gamma rays, it just kind of goes into the mix. Yes, sir.
Is it, according to your explanation, it's not correct to think that that inequality between matter and antimatter in the after inflation but before the reheating phase, is that the actual origin of life?
So it would have been actually part of the reheating phase to be discussed. So the reheating phase is just everything that happened that wasn't cold.
Sure.
So it's just a catch-all. The origin of light. So it's hard to know what you mean by origin of light, because light is just one of the. It's just. Photons are just an element particle. They existed during inflation. They existed after inflation.
But the collision of matter and antimatter produces gamma rays.
That's right.
It
does, yes, but it's entirely, we can, but one of the, And you can imagine, yes, so that's the first time light shows up on the scene. You can imagine that. That is a live possibility. But it is equally valid to assume that the light came first and made the matter in any manner. So it could be, could be true, we just don't know.
But light, there was light during the inflationary period.
Sure, I mean, you could have had it. There just wasn't anything around to make it.
Heat seems to be important to you in the formation of the nucleus.
And it's important to you too.
I asked you 2 weeks ago why this had to be the first universe that there was, why it wasn't there.
Right.
Maybe an infinite number before. Mm-hmm. And I think your answer was what happened to heat of many previous universes.
Right.
Is it theoretically possible that our universe could just completely cool down to nothing, zero, or absolute zero, or
mm-hmm.
would the heat just transform into another type of energy, or?
So the subject of my ninth lecture will be what happens at the end of the time. One of the possibilities is this precisely a heat death where the universe just cools completely off. And this goes basically to having zero energy density.
Then what?
Your guess is as good as mine. I'm sorry.
So the one that you're using now is something other than the moment of singularity where everything is observable. Can you fix it precisely? Is it a matter of reheating or something like that before that, after that?
I'm not sure what I mean by giving you a precise definition. It's just, what I described to you is
the ballpark.
That is the ballpark. It's just that whole process. You can just call that the big. That period was the Big Bang.
Right. Does it include inflation? For
if you wanted to, there's an Oxford English Dictionary entry on Big Bang. If you want to take that to be this is a tech as a technical term of science. We aren't sure of the physics yet. And so until we know exactly the story, it's hard to, the term remains slippery.
Is there some reason why you want to consider it to include other than the singularity itself? Because certainly up until you mentioned this, I had never heard of it in many lectures in cosmology, used in any sense other than I thought, the moment of the singularity.
Right, but I think that's what most people mean. But I guess in my mind, there's not much of a bang. There's no bangs at the beginning of inflation. It's just sort of fast and it's just sort of a whoosh. It's a big whoosh at the beginning of inflation, and then you get an explosion, and that's what starts. And that's what every heating, there's a big explosion with a huge release of energy. And to my mind, if you want to talk about the bang, that's a bang. And inflation isn't much of a bang. It's like starting blowing a balloon as a bang. The bang kind of comes on the balloon pop. And so that's why my personal objection to using that term as describing the singularity. If somebody else wants to use it that in the other way, they're not wrong to, because we're still we just haven't settled down, I think, absolutely into a fixed nomenclature. And so I figure that, I'm a professional cosmologist, I get to use the word if I want to. but I agree that my usage is non-standard, so that's why I can apologize for it. But I'm not retreating just because of the other guys. I'm going to keep the bang of bang.
You said that dark matter responds to this weak force?
We think so, but we're not sure.
What effect would that have on dark matter? Would that cause
dark matter?
Weak matter, the weak force causes the disintegration or the
radioactivity. Right.
So would that cause dark matter to dissociate?
No. So if dark matter were itself a composite particle, then it would allow it to dissociate. What we think is it's a bit weird. So I can give you just a few more details, and this will help to explain. So what the weak force is in fact the existence of two fundamental, so let me just take one more step back. So electromagnetism works by exchange of photons. So the reason, the way that positive and negative charges talk to each other is by exchanging photons. And photons weigh nothing, which is why electromagnetism can go along across long distances, and is quite strong. The weak force exchanges something else. Two things we call W and Z bosons. So W and Z bosons play the same role for the weak force that photons play for the electrical force. So W and Z bosons weigh a lot, which means that they can't travel very far. And that's why the weak force is so weak. It's just essentially because it's constrained to only interact over very short distances. And its characteristic interaction strength is also just intrinsically quite weak. And so in an atom, inside of a nucleus that's an unstable nucleus, every once in a while you generate one of these W or Z bosons, and it allows a transition where you have a neutron switches to being a proton and a neutron, and it escapes. And that switch is mediated by this weak nuclear force. And so the dark matter, if it's weakly interacting, is something else. It's not like any of the other stuff. It's something that all, it just zooms around. And then if it gets close to something like a nucleus, then every once in a while, a dark matter particle will be zooming through a nucleus, and then the nucleus and the dark matter particle will swap a W or a Z boson. And then a nuclear reaction will happen. And it'll be like stimulated decay. And so and then you'll shoot out some energy by having this interaction happen. But that's how its weak force would operate. So it itself has no internal structure. It's just a point, or almost like a point. And it would only hit nuclei very rarely by every once in a while as it's passing along, swapping these fundamental particles. I don't know if that clarifies anything at all.
So two dark matter particles would not interact through the weak force?
Oh, they could too, yeah. They absolutely can. In fact, so at Fermilab, he's a co-professor at Chicago, we actually have one of the world experts on exactly figuring out how often that can happen. It's a man named Dan Hooper, who has a nice book on dark matter. He knows a lot about dark matter. And then there's a scary amount about dark matter, in fact. And one of the funny things about him is that he's so good at doing, I was talking about physicists being good at inventing new things, and he is really good at inventing new things. So he's always very quick about coming up with new theories to explain things. One of his things it's not quite a hobby horse, one of the things he's very interested in is that in the center of galaxies, so we have all this dark matter in galaxies. We're sure it's there. So one of the big questions is how much dark matter is at the core of the galaxy, because as you go closer and closer to the center of a galaxy, then the dark matter density goes up higher and higher, because essentially the gravitational force is causing it to concentrate in the center. And if you get to a sufficiently high density of these dark matter particles in the core of the galaxy, right around where the black hole, the center of our galaxy is, then you can actually just have these dark matter particles hit each other every once in a while. And they would emit gamma rays, it turns out. If you do the calculation, then they characteristically will emit gamma rays. And I already told you that we know that there are some gamma rays coming from the core of the galaxy. And so there's this big debate that goes back and forth that when we see all these gamma rays coming from the core of the galaxy, and we're not sure we think that we know where all of them come from, but he has argued for some time now that there is a little bit extra, and he thinks that these are coming from dark matter self-interaction, and it could be true.
One follow-up question.
Yeah.
Electric charge has plus and minus,
yes,
and the photons mediate both.
Right.
Does the weak force also have a plus and a minus?
It has something that goes under the name of hypercharge, which is like plus and minus, but it's a weak force. It has fractional values, I think. I can't remember at some point in grad school I knew some of my arbitrary values all about them, but I don't remember them anymore. But yes, it has an analogy. But my favorite really is, so the strong nuclear force also has something like positive ions, but there's three. There's three charges for the strong. And I'm switching, I'm not answering your question because I don't remember the answer to your question. And so I'm switching to something I knew the answer to. So don't accuse me of being a politician. But so there's the three, for the strong nuclear forces, we call them either red, blue, and green. We usually call it three colors. It's like red, blue, and green. And they act as sort of a triplet of charges, and they each charge acts a little differently than the other ones. And so, and my recollection is there's a very similar story for like for the weak force, but I can't remember the detail. But you can look it up. I should know. Any other questions?